Okay, great. Welcome everyone, and thank you for the organization of this virtual seminar series. Yes, so I want to talk about a topic that I started thinking a couple of years ago, energy constrained diamond norms. So this is about the norms and topology of quantum channels, really. And so I will just explain you a little bit of my motivation to get there, and then we'll discuss obviously a definition, the so-called energy constrained diamond norms, and then a couple of applications, namely the ones mentioned in the title. So I don't know if you can see the pointer, but okay, so there's an archive preprint which I never got around to publishing. It has some imperfections that need to be fixed, and somehow for various reasons this has not been published yet, but you can read about most of the things I'm saying. You can read about so let me start directly with the motivation that brought me there. So I'm thinking about quantum dynamics, a lot of the time I'm thinking about just a quantum channel, a simple transformation from states to states. So N is a noisy quantum channel for me that maps states on a system A, Hilbert space A, to states with a Hilbert space B. So S of A and S of B are simply just density matrices, if you want. And so by general consensus, quantum channel means completely positive and trace preserving map. So for this discussion here, there's already something in the chat. Oh, sorry, sir. I'm trying to monitor the chat, but I have to close the window, otherwise I don't see my own slides. So if there's a question, hopefully somebody will alert me that I have to read it. We want to talk about energy in this system. So that means at least on the A system, on the input system of this channel, there's a Hamiltonian. And for normalization purposes, I will assume that it's bounded below by zero. Or we can even say that the smallest energy will be the smallest eigenvalue in zero. Okay, so in the communication theory or the quantum information theory, a very important quantity we like to know more about is the capacity of the channel when we have access to asymptotically many uses of this channel. And we have an energy constraint on the input signals. So this looks as follows. So we're looking at the tensor product extension of the channel. So we assume it's just memoryless. It's not the most necessary assumption, but we will stick to it during the talk. And it's very common in practical scenarios. So this maps N of the A systems to N of the B systems. And we assume that we have the sort of natural way of extending the Hamiltonian from a single system to N, namely just by adding them. This is HA1 acting on A1, tensored with the identity in all the others. The second term is HA2 acting on A2, tensored with the identity in all others, and so on. So there's no interaction between the system. The Hamiltonian is really just a way of assessing the energy. For the people who are not familiar with capacities, I have a bit of a cartoon picture of how to think about the capacity of a channel. This is really about, it's a sort of an engineering problem. You want to send information, which is a number of k of bits. And if you use the channel n times, the rate is called k divided by n. It's k over n. So to send information for each message, we will have to, so each message that's a k-bit string, we will have to associate an input state. So there comes some sort of modulator which does that, sticks it into the channels, and then the receiver will have to decode, which in the quantum mechanical setting means it's a measurement, a suitable measurement to obtain a estimate of the message. So there are a couple of things to consider here. So first of all, we want this energy bound. So we want that the Hamiltonian evaluated on the state should be at least n times e. So this, the energy bound is interpreted as an energy bound per system, just as the rate is number of bit per system. And we want that the message is recovered, maybe not necessarily always, but with high probability. So this m hat is equal to m with probability 1 minus epsilon. And so a code in which is this thing here, this modulation scheme, the measurement and so on, is a very complicated object, and we were interested in the maximum rate as n goes to infinity. So this is a difficult mathematical problem in general, but over the years, various researchers have made progress on this. And I should say, I presented this in the quantum setting, but this really goes back to Shannon's work on classical information transmission via noisy channels from 1948, where he had exactly the same thing. So he was looking at continuous alphabet systems, where without a energy constraint, you trivially have infinite capacity. You can just squeeze any amount of information in a single channel. And so to have a good assessment of what the channel can do, you need to see what is the trade-off between communication rate and energy you expend. Okay, so very similar to what Shannon did in 48, there is a theorem by Alexander Kholevo from, well, more than 20 years ago now, that gives some kind of formula for the capacity. In practice, in many cases, it's not very useful, but at least it makes a link to information theoretical quantities, to entropies, and it goes like this. The fundamental quantity is this chi of Ne. So this depends on the channel and the energy. It's the supremum of something that I call, or we, many people call the Kholevo information or a mutual information between a variable X and the output system B. It's a supremum over ensembles of this form. So we can choose any alphabet X, we have probabilities P sub X, and we can choose input states rho X. So these guys live on the input system. They are states in A. And the Kholevo quantity is this one here. It's the von Neumann entropy of the average output state minus the average over the von Neumann entropies of the output state of n of rho x. And so in information theoretical terms, a very elegant way of writing this is just as a mutual information for this bipartite state rho xb, where we have a mixture of all x with probability px, we have a projector on x, so these are meant to be orthogonal, tensor n of rho x. So this is an artificial x system, and this is the b system. And of course, we have the energy constraints, so that the average energy over the ensemble is bounded by E. So this is just a mathematical definition. These are just numbers, right? I don't have any kind of discussion of code and engineering here. Okay, can you please use a pointer so we know when the page you are? I was trying to do this thing before, so I thought I used a pointer before. The thing is the mouse. Can someone help me?
We can see the pointer here.
Not everybody can, apparently.
But now we can see it, but before we could not indeed.
Yeah, so as soon as it's on the page, you can't see it, I suppose. That is really annoying. Maybe like this. Okay.
Yeah, it works.
Okay, well, never mind. Now it goes. It's amazing. Okay. I really don't know why it changes between point and mouse. So it's a bit distracting. So this chi quantity is just a maximum over some expression in terms of entropies, a very complicated maximum itself, but it doesn't contain the code. And then we need to regularize this. This is this limit here. We need to evaluate chi for n tensor n with energy bound n times e. And so this line up here, this is the capacity formula. C of n e is this limit when n goes to infinity. And so Well, okay, so I don't want to talk about it, but I mean, for the people who are into this, there are, of course, plenty of other different channel capacities for quantum channels, for example, the quantum and private capacity. For most of them, we have similar capacities, similar limits of entropic expressions. Okay, so what I want to say is, in general, this limit, unfortunately, is necessary because this chi quantity is not additive, so chi of n tensor n of 2e in general is larger than twice chi of n. And so the capacity can be strictly larger than this chi quantity. And this makes a big difference because at least in the finite dimensional setting, chi is at least computable. You can phrase this as a optimization problem over a continuous function, actually a concave function with finitely many variables. And so that doesn't sound so bad. But the limit is what gets us, this regularization limit. So the fact that it's not additive, this has been known since for more than 10 years now. The good news is for some class of channels, it is additive. And so that means that this chi of n tensor n comma ne is equal to chi of ne times n. And so for those cases, we know that the capacity is equal to chi. And for those channels, we say, oh, we know what the capacity, we can in some sense claim we know what the capacity is. So for example, a very nice and fairly recent result is that so-called phase covariant Gaussian channels, they satisfy this as a result by Giovannetti, Rolevo, Garcia Padron, and Werner. In the formula, for example, for the very, very simple case of
May I ask, so what would be the classical analog of this theorem by Rolevo? Would it be
analog? Yes. So this is, I mean, the very first one is in Shannon's theory of channels with continuous alphabet.
Yeah, so a classical analog of a channel is
a stochastic kernel.
Okay, and so if you repeat this classically, do you get anything interesting or?
Of course, sure. So I should say. So this is of course the problem with online talks. You cannot improvise like this. This contains actually Shannon's result because we can, at least for countable alphabet, we can mock a classical channel as a quantum channel by simply introducing.
Actually, you can improvise. There is a whiteboard in Zoom.
Okay, but I don't have a tablet, so I cannot easily draw. So I will not attempt this. I know. Yes, yeah. Just to say that. So in a certain sense, this contains Shannon's result, even though we cannot. I mean, it's not that straightforward to deal with uncountable alphabet. So for example, Shannon was considering a channel where the input is a real number and the output is a real number. And they are related by just additive noise process. And so the difference of the input and the output is simply distributed according to some internal distribution. And this noise could be, for example, Gaussian noise, so additive white Gaussian noise. That would be a special case of this theory here. And of course, that's where it comes from. So the motivation of Shannon was communication of electromagnetic fields, where the mode degrees of freedom, they are just real amplitudes, and so that's your elementary channel is just what happens to the amplitude of a single mode. So the motivation for Rolevo and company was the quantum optical analog. How to communicate through quantum electromagnetic field. And in the simplest case, it's just a single mode. So you will have, for example, the energy operator in that case will be simply the harmonic Hamiltonian of a bosonic mode.
And so the channel and the Hamiltonian are completely unrelated, or do they have to be compatible?
They can be completely unrelated. They can be completely unrelated. Yes. Yeah. I mean, physically, that makes sense because the Hamiltonian is somehow the cost, the energy that the modulator expends to prepare a state. The channel is then physically in a different location. You know, the modulator just sends off the system, and then as the electromagnetic wave propagates to space, it undergoes the noise. So it's a different thing. So these are just separate inputs to this, to the problem. Okay. Can I continue?
Yeah.
Okay. So I just wanted to discuss this example. So the quantum analog of additive Gaussian noise is a well studied example. So this is something that you can build in the lab, where you simply let a single bosonic mode, so a single photonic mode, interact in a beam splitter with a thermal background, and one of the two legs of the output will be the output of the quantum additive noise channel. And so the noise is measured also in units of energy, which are proportional to photon numbers in the normalization that I choose. And then the capacity has this formula. So this follows from the result I just quoted. It's just a simple function of E and R. Of the noise energy. And G is this function here. So this is something you hopefully can remember, x plus 1 log x plus 1 minus x log x. So this is somehow, this is a fundamental function to quantify the entropy in continuous variable systems. So in this formula, we can see, okay, this is indeed continuous, both in the energy and in the channel parameter. I mean, I have a one parameter of families here because R could range from 0 to infinity. And this is just a continuous function. And so the question I want to address, I mean, the one question that you have to address when you study these capacities, in general, is the capacity a continuous function of the channel? So when N is just a CPTP map from the set of all allowed channels. And so continuity, of course, is with respect to the natural topology, which in this case should be the strong topology, so the pointwise convergence of channels.
Is the Hilbert space finite dimensional, or?
Not necessarily. So actually, the main reason why you introduce the energy constraint is because you are in infinite dimension, but of course you could have an energy constraint also in finite dimension. But yeah, let's think about separable Hilbert space. That's the main area of applications.
The energy is typically the number operator, does it matter what kind of an operator is it?
Of course, it does matter. Yeah, sure. So the capacity, I mean the formula. Sorry, if you stare a little bit at the formula. The energy bound here, that depends explicitly on the Hamiltonian, right? So the kind of whatever this is and its behavior should depend on the Hamiltonian.
Yeah. So is it typically unbounded, the energy, or it doesn't matter?
It will be unbounded in the case where it's useful. For this definition to make sense, it doesn't have to be bounded. It doesn't have to be unbounded or bounded. It kind of doesn't matter. But yes. So for example, for this example here, right? So the Hamiltonian is simply the number operator.
Yeah, okay.
Unboundedness of the Hamiltonian is not enough. I mean, you want a Hamiltonian so that the energy bound somehow cuts off your Hilbert space in a meaningful way. So you don't get infinities. But you will see this when we come to the later discussion. So I want to discuss the continuity first in the finite dimensional setting because that's somehow the background on which we know much more. So the question was here, is the capacity continuous in N? Actually, I'm sorry, I dropped the continuity in E, but you can actually deal by the techniques that I show you. You can also see continuity in E later on. But the continuity in N somehow is the more critical one because it's some sort of stability result. Okay, so from continuity, I'm going now to uniform continuity. So in finite dimensions, it makes sense. And in finite dimension, of course, it's also true that any of those, I mean, I can always think of the topology of the on the CP maps on the quantum channels as coming from a norm. This is a linear space after all. And so I want to make the case that the natural norm, well, actually this case has been made before, a natural norm, but which was, I think, first suggested by Kitaev, and I'm referring to this paper with a broader discussion, Aronov, Kitaev, and Nissan, they call it the diamond norm. And there's this definition, it's the supremum. So this delta, sorry, the diamond norm of delta, where delta is a Hermitian preserving map, it's a supremum of delta tensor identity acting on some state. And you evaluate the trace norm. So why do we obsess about this thing? Well,
tensor identity on any dimension, I mean.
Any other Hilbert space, exactly. So the supremum contains the Hilbert space.
So it's kind of a natural norm for completely positive maps.
Exactly. So this is the completely bounded version of the Schatten 1 to Schatten 1 norm. Okay. That's in functional analytic terms. For the information theories, this is a very natural choice because it quantifies exactly the statistical distinguishability of channels. So if you have, for example, two channels to choose from, but you don't know which one is inside a black box, you only know some of it with probability p, it's n, with probability 1 minus p, it's m. So maybe you can see this here. So the most general way you can try to distinguish the two channels is you could create an auxiliary system C. You can create a state rho on the A tensor C system. You can use the channel, and then you can measure the output and make a choice on whether it's N or M. And so if you optimize over all these choices you can make, so that's exactly the supremum here of C and of a rho, and the measurement optimization is somehow folded into the trace norm here, the minimum probability of error you make is this one here. It's 1/2 1 minus the diamond norm of Pn minus 1 minus Pn. So this is somehow the justification why we are interested in this particular norm. I mean, obviously in finite dimension, they are all equivalent, but since I want uniform continuity, I want a quantitative expression. I'll commit to this one here. And so then you can prove the following. So for example, so this is somehow the model for this kind of question of the continuity. If the output system is finite dimension, so in the finite dimension case, let's forget about the energy bound, or let's put the energy bound simply larger than the norm of the Hamiltonian, so that it's trivial, so that I drop the E dependence in the formulas here below. If the system is finite dimensional, a uniform bound, so in particular, an explicit uniform bound on the difference of the capacities can be shown as follows. So if the two channels are close in diamond norm, so you might ask, why do I put this factor of 1/2 here? This is to make the norm between 0 and 1. It's just a normalization thing. If this is less than or equal than epsilon, so it means the channels are somehow not very distinguishable, then first the chi quantities of the two channels are close to each other when epsilon is small, and also the capacities are close to each other. And there are these explicit upper bounds that only depend on the norm difference.
Excuse me, what is the absolute value of B?
Oh, sorry. Jargon. That's my preferred notation for the dimension. So like I said, okay. If B is finite dimensional, then this is a number.
This is the dimension of the underlying Hilbert space, or or of the state space.
Hilbert space.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry, it's a shorthand I like to use. Yeah, just and, briefly show.
And how G is always this funny function.
Yes. Exactly. These are the functions from the whole level theory. And G is this entropic function. Yes, yeah. Which goes to zero when epsilon goes to zero. So that's just a kind of a brief hint how Lehmann Smith did this for the classical capacity, but also for a number of other capacity expressions. So the main insight is if you simply plug the same state into the two channels, the fact that they are close in diamond norm, this implies that the output states are close to in trace norm. And so we can use uniform continuity bounds for the entropy. And so Funnis inequality shows that the difference of the entropies is bounded by epsilon log times the dimension of Hilbert space B plus G of E. And okay, I'm giving a reference here where this bound here is optimized in this form. And so what you simply do is you just use the same input ensemble to the two channels and you bound the difference of the corresponding output entropies. So this is very straightforward. The tricky part is capacity because we have to do this many copy regularization, and the mathematical challenge is when you look at n tensor n and m tensor n, their diamond norm distance will increase. Well, not monotonically, but it will converge to the maximum because of the distinguishability interpretation. When you have access to many copies of the channel, eventually you can distinguish them with arbitrary precision. So what you do is you introduce some kind of a telescoping trick where you interpolate between n tensor m and m tensor n by these channels here. These channels that have few copies, some number of systems it acts with n, and with the remaining system it acts with m. And so comparing nk and nk minus 1, they only differ in one of those n different systems, namely in the kth one, where I'm swapping a k for an m. And so by stability properties of this completely bounded norm, of this diamond norm, the diamond norm difference of these two channels is still less than or equal to epsilon. And so that means when I'm looking again at the output states if I fix one input state and I'm just looking at the output state of the channel, those will be in trace distance close to each other. And so then we can do the following trick. If we now compare the entropy of rho k and rho k minus 1, I can rewrite this as a conditional entropy of the k system conditioned on all the others. So like here, the bk, maybe I glossed over it too fast in the cartoon picture of communication. I have these n systems, a1 to an on the input and b1 through bn on the output. And here I'm looking at the output system, b1, b2 up to bn. So I'm going to look at the conditional entropy of bk conditioned on all the other b's with respect to one state minus the conditional entropy of the same two systems with respect to the other state. Why this is true is because rho k and rho k minus 1 are the same on all the b different from k. And because there is this beautiful continuity bound for the conditional entropy, which only features the dimension of the first system and not the second, and it looks like this here, that the difference will be bounded by 2 epsilon sil log of the dimension of b plus the g function. And then again, we just used it to compare the whole information for the output ensemble of nk and nk minus 1. Okay, sorry, I got a bit carried away with explaining all of those things. I have to watch my time. Anyway, this is good, fantastic. We are at the end of the information theoretical part. So now you earned a bit of a little break, of course. Yeah, this is what it looked like this morning, more or less. So now let's jump into what are the issues when we want to do this in infinite dimension. So the first one is there is no funnels or other bound for the continuity of the entropy, because the entropy is simply not continuous with respect to the trace node, period. And second, the diamond norm is not a good choice to measure the distance of two channels, because it doesn't induce the strong topology, but a much, much finer one, and somehow a useless one, as we will see, or as maybe many of you are aware of. And so the first issue is actually not that serious, because for the in my motivation, I'm looking at energy constrained communication. So my input states are already energy bounded, and maybe if I'm talking about bosonic or photonic communication, the output system is also a bosonic mode, and I have also an energy bound there, hopefully. And so if I have that, then I can resort to the inside as well with bounded energy, at least for respect to the number operator. And other well-behaved Hamiltonians, the entropy is continuous. And in fact, you can even make a uniform continuity statement. I refer here to an older paper, but I will bring this up explicitly. And the second objection, this is precisely why we introduced the energy constrained version of the diamond norm, where essentially this optimization in the definition of all input states rho is replaced by states with bounded energy. And again, this makes sense for arbitrary Hamiltonian, but it's useful only when the Hamiltonian is somehow sufficiently well behaved. So the version of the energy constraint diamond norm I'm going to discuss goes back to Maxim Shirokov from this paper that was eventually published in 2018. But we also found an early attempt that is not exactly what we need, but it's topologically equivalent in this Pirandolide paper here. Good. Okay, so for the uniform continuity, so the statement is as follows. We need a Hamiltonian, so as I said, we assume it's positive to have a kind of explicit lower bound on the energy. I need that it has a discrete spectrum, and in fact, I need that the Gibbs state is well defined. I mean, it has a bona fide Gibbs state that maximizes the entropy, and this entropy has to be finite for every energy. So in that case, it looks like this. It looks like e to the minus beta h divided by the partition function. Beta is some function of the energy, depending on the Hamiltonian. Yeah, so I need that this here makes sense for all beta larger than zero and has to have finite entropy. And then you can prove the following. If two states on a, so I give you already the most general version. This is Alitsky-Funnis for conditional entropy and with an energy constraint. If you have two states on a bipartite system, so A, B is A tensor B from two Hilbert spaces, on the A system, we have the Hamiltonian. So trace of rho A and trace of sigma A. So these are these energy expectation values. They are bounded by E. And I have a trace norm difference, and it's kind of the subscript one is gone missing here, but this is a trace norm here, rho minus sigma. This is less than epsilon. And if delta is the square root of this epsilon, then the following is true. The difference of the conditional entropies of with respect to rho and of sigma is bounded by this here. So what is let's read it from the right. There's the delta G function again. So this again is some kind of small additive constant. And here I have six times delta times the entropy of one of those Gibbs states, but not of energy G, not of energy E, sorry, but the slightly larger one. I just have to normalize E divided by delta. The fact is, if this term here, this is something Shirokov proved, this is monotonic in delta. When delta goes to zero, this will go to zero under the above assumptions. So obviously there are many Hamiltonians that don't satisfy this, but luckily the number operator and all these kind of Hamiltonians from the quantum optics, they do. And that's where most of the good news are. So this entropy here, this is some kind of a term that stands for the log of the dimension.
Log
of the dimension is just the largest entropy in a d-dimensional system, and with the energy bound, we will simply have sort of an effective cutoff that has to do with the entropy of some suitably highly energetic Gibbs state.
Excuse me, what is beta? I mean, the Gibbs state depends on the inverse temperature beta, but it is not mentioned in the lemma.
Because it depends, that depends on the Hamiltonian. So G of E is for me simply defined to be the state that maximizes the entropy at energy E. Gamma of E is the entropy maximum. Then there exists a beta, which is a function of E that has this, so that is
okay. Yes?
So I don't parameterize my Gibbs states by the inverse temperature, but by the energy.
Okay. Yes. Okay. I got it.
Yeah. So this takes some getting used to, but it's the natural way of dealing with it in this setting. And it makes sense because beta, of course, is then a very complicated function of the energy depending on the Hamiltonian. Okay, so the second, this takes care of the first issue that I mentioned. The second issue is putting an energy constraint in the diamond norm. And so, like I said, what we do is we have exactly the same optimization when we have our Hermitian preserving delta, which in practice will be just the difference of two completely positive maps. Tensor with identity, we apply it to a state row and take the trace norm. Only that we want states, so row are states on A tensor C, where the reduced state of A has the energy bound. So notice that the Hamiltonian is always acting on A and not on C. That's important because we are also taking supremum over C. If you want, there is no, that we simply assume a trivial contribution of the energy on C. Which, by the way, so for the people who are wondering about why I cite all these different papers here, the difference in the Pirandola and his collaborators' work is that they had a very concrete system C, which they thought of as related to the A, and they, for them, it was much more natural to impose a Hamiltonian also there. So that's why the two definitions are not exactly the same, but they are related. Okay, so if under our assumptions that the Hamiltonian has indeed smallest eigenvalue zero and that E is positive, that means this optimization is not empty, and in that, under those conditions, this will indeed define a norm. When you stare at it by convexity of the trace norm, you can see that it's enough to consider pure states here, and that means we can also restrict to C, which are isomorphic to A. So if A is finite dimensional, well, okay, C will be of the same Hilbert space of the same finite dimension. If A is separable, C will be just another separable space. So I just want, as a disclaimer, all these norms, they turn out to be equivalent, but each somehow quantifies, I mean, the actual number of this thing, of what the value of this norm is, quantifies in a different way the distinguishability of the channels under probe states with different energy. So as the energy grows, we have to assume that this distinguishability grows. And indeed, of course, you can see this definition is monotonic in E. Okay, so before we go to the applications, let's get the basic mathematical properties of this definition out of the way. So by definition, like I said, A, these diamond norms with energy bound E are monotonic in E for a fixed delta. I said it already, but there's a quantitative statement. They are equivalent to each other in the usual Banach setting. They're dominating each other with suitable constants. Namely, if E is less than F, then delta diamond norm E is less than or equal to delta diamond norm F. And this is less than or equal to F divided by E diamond norm delta of E. So topologically there, we don't gain anything by choosing a particular E, but the number actually should say something. The good old diamond norm is recovered simply as the supremum over E, because that means we get rid of the energy constraint. And so D is a beautiful observation that actually I didn't register myself at first, so I learned it from Maxim Shirokov. The convergence with respect to the norm for any E implies strong convergence. So the topology is at least as strong as the strong convergence. And for a discrete Hamiltonian with finite degeneracies, for example, a system composed of finitely many bosonic modes with the sum of the number operators as H, the two topologies are the same. So the topology for discrete H with finite degeneracy, the topology of induced by this diamond norm with E is the strong topology. So we don't, topologically, we are on safe territory. That's kind of good. But there is this quantitative thing. So how should we choose the energy bound? And, okay, that comes from the applications. So yeah, so let's go to my original motivations as a communication engineer. The uniform continuity of the channel capacity so where both input and output space are now separable Hilbert spaces, and with an energy bound. So now it turns out it's for the capacity formula, it's enough that we have an energy constraint on A. For the continuity, I also need a Hamiltonian on B with similar properties. In particular, I need that it has these skip states for all energies. And let's assume that the channel is so-called energy limited. So what it means is that if you stick in an energy bounded input state, rho, so the energy that's now measured with respect to HA, this implies that the output state has a sort of a uniformly bounded energy. So this E tilde has to be a function of E. Turns out the only function you have to consider is a linear affine function. There is a concise way of rephrasing this in terms of the adjoint map in the Heisenberg picture. What this means is that N adjoint acting on HB is less than or equal than alpha HA plus an offset. This is an assumption that it doesn't worry me that much, because in all of those Gaussian channels and other bosonic channels, this is usually given. We know we have natural Hamiltonians and the channel does not introduce unlimited energy into the system. And so we have some kind of uniform continuity bound imitating the tricks from Leung and Smith, both for the chi and for the C quantity. And it looks like this: if the diamond norm distance between N and M for a particular energy is bounded by epsilon, and delta is the square root of epsilon, then you can bound the difference between the two capacities in a uniform way as follows. So we have this some constant times delta times, again, the entropy of a Gibbs state. And now this is a Gibbs state on the output system. And so that's where the E tilde comes from. E tilde is this one. E tilde is this thing up here. It's the output energy that corresponds to E and the input, plus the G function again. So this, again, for delta small and for epsilon small, this is just a small additive constant. And this is simply a small number times a Gibbs entropy. And so, yeah, Leung and Smith, we can use this telescoping trick in the corresponding entropic continuity bounds also in this case. Okay, so and in the remaining time that I have, which is not that much, I want to discuss another application, which is only very briefly discussed in my preprint. But since then, other people have taken up their suggestions from this paper and developed this much more. Okay, so where do I start here? So the basic type of time convolution in quantum system, of course, is the unitary one. It's just a one parameter unitary group, and then slightly more generally, the one parameter semigroups of in open systems. So those two types I want to consider here. They both have the property, well, the unitary one always in the one parameter semigroup case, somehow in the good scenario, they are strongly continuous. I mean, in some sense, this is somehow is kind of a requirement. We wouldn't consider a physical time evolution if you didn't have this. So the what this means is that that the evolution operator, the map that takes you from time zero to time t, that's a CP map. This is a function that is continuous in time, right? And so we want strong, I mean, the correct notion of this is strong continuity. And so what I want to show you is that in some cases and with suitable Hamiltonians, this can be expressed as uniform continuity with respect to this energy bounded diamond one. So it's kind of nice. At least, well, nice both because we can do quantitative things and also for people with more primitive geometric minds who prefer norms to mere topologies. Okay, so let's see how this goes. So I want to, I think in the preprint I discussed the case of the pure loss bosonic channel. So what this does is this ket alpha, these are the Glauber-Sudarshan coherent states. They are, so the coherent state alpha is simply mapped to eta alpha, where eta is some complex number with modulus less than equal to one. So this is, that's a pure attenuating channel. And so what you can convince yourself is that the diamond norm, and this is what I promised before, this is an example where the diamond norm is clearly completely useless. So this eta is a parameter, right? This kind of this whole two parameter family of channels. For any eta different from eta prime, those two channels have diamond norm difference two, which is the maximum value. And so in the statistical terms, that means you can distinguish them with arbitrarily small error probability by choosing the correct input state. So what kind of input state would that be? Well, you plug in a coherent state of sufficiently large alpha. So the one channel will map it to eta alpha, the other one to eta prime alpha. And if eta is different from eta prime, you can make the absolute difference between those two output coherent states, between those two parameters, arbitrarily large in the complex plane. But the distinguishability, the trace norm difference between those two output states depends on the absolute difference of these two complex numbers. So you can make this unbounded.
So but the Hamiltonian is the number operator.
Yes, yeah, of course I forgot to say this. Yes, yeah, exactly. In this case, exactly, this should be the number operator.
Yes. Maybe a stupid question, but how do you realize such a pure loss channel in a lab?
So this is realized by a beam splitter, by a beam splitter with transmissivity eta. Let's say eta is just a real number. It's the simplest case. The complex one is just a phase. So on the one leg, you have your coherent state coming in. On the other leg, you have to make sure that you have the vacuum. So this has to become from a very cold reservoir to be as close to the vacuum as possible. And then the two output legs from the beam splitter, they will carry two attenuated versions of eta, of alpha, sorry. So this is a very primitive channel, and kind of in free space, for example, free space communication is considered to be very well approximated by this. In outer space, or even in the atmosphere, the distance is not too large. The dominating feature is just a loss, so it's just basically losing the photon. And a good approximation of this mechanism is this one. If you don't have any kind of background thermal field. So the diamond norm, the ordinary diamond norm is maximal. And this comes because we can optimize over all states, in particular arbitrary, highly energetic coherent states. So the with the number operator, the energy of a coherent state alpha is modulus alpha squared. And so you can, but for the, with the energy bound, you can make a quantitative statement, and it looks like this. So you're stealing some results from Ranjit Nair, who did the calculation for a closely related quantity. You can show the following. So the diamond norm difference between those two channels, the lossy channel eta and lossy of eta prime, is bound by this quantity. And mu is simply the ratio of eta and eta prime. So I did it, I wrote this here for real numbers, but you can do a similar thing for complex numbers. And so when eta and eta prime are close, then mu is close to one, just a little bit less. And so this will be arbitrarily close to zero. But of course, it will still diverge when e goes to infinity, right? So when eta is different from eta prime, mu is less than one. So if I take the, oops, so there should be a 1/2 here. So there should be a 1/2 missing. Okay, sorry. Then this right-hand side goes to one. Okay, so let's look at the unitary evolution because that's kind of nice too. So for unitary Schrödinger evolution, of course, this is a kind of classic topic in quantum mechanics. Whenever you have a reasonable Hamiltonian, it defines a genuine unitary, and it's defined like this. Originally on a dense subspace and then extended by continuity. And okay, no surprise, for the energy bound, we will take the same Hamiltonian, right? So let's assume we take H to be the very Hamiltonian that defines the time evolution. Again, we have this kind of annoying feature of the diamond norm that UT and UT prime for two different primes, for two different times, sorry, will be CP maps, they're unitary conjugations, but they're particular CP maps at maximum diamond norm distance, at least for a dense set of time differences. The dense set comes about because when you think about it, you might have some periodicity in your Hamiltonian, and then of course this will not happen. And by the way, here I'm explicitly assuming that the Hamiltonian is unbounded. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. Yes, yeah. So this statement is true for unbounded Hamiltonian and for a dense set of T minus T prime. And again, with the energy bound in the paper, I show a very simple and very primitive upper bound between those two CP maps for the difference of these two CP maps, so UT and U0. You get this here. So this looks a bit weird, the third root of 16 times TE, but at least qualitatively it somehow hits the right mark. Why? Because there are these classic results called quantum speed limits by Margolos and Levitin, and they are about how much time does a state of energy E require to evolve to an orthogonal state or to a state which has some kind of bounded inner product with the original state. And their bounds are, well, this time is some constant divided by E, at least. And so this, we can see this indeed coming out, but there's some kind of a quantitative statement here also for small times, how fast it can move away. So I was never very happy with the third root, I should say, and for good reason, because very shortly after I wrote my paper, I was taught by Simon Becker and Nilanjana Datta that in fact, a better bound where the third root is, where the cube root is replaced by a square root can be proved. And this is up to the constant indeed optimal, so that the square root has to be there. And I think we know for unitaries, exactly. It has to be like that. And so, yeah, the paper that I gave the reference down here, It contains a whole lot of other interesting observations and many different results. And in particular, instead of just using the energy bound, they introduce a whole one parameter family of norms where you use the same Hamiltonian to bound different moments of the energy distribution. So this for real parameter alpha, they consider bounds constraints of this form, trace of rho modulus h to the alpha should be less than e to the alpha. And so this alpha I don't remember in the paper, it could be any positive number, basically. The results may not be valid for all alphas. Anyway, so they have a whole family of such upper bounds for those modified energy bounds. So I just want to finish talking about a vast generalization of this in for one parameter dynamical semigroups. In the case that you have sort of a Lindblad style generator, so you can, in the case that you can write the generator really in this form, L of rho has this unit, the Hamiltonian part, and it has some purely, it has this dissipative part here. So this is kind of the familiar form, which we know is the canonical form in for norm continuous semigroups, but if you only want strongly continuous, these operators might be unbounded, and then we have problems. I mean, there are evident issues with even defining this. So one way out of this is, let's just assume that all these operators are defined on the same dense subspace, and then I can write these kind of expressions, and that defines, it densely defines this this generator, and under suitable conditions, this will then give me a strongly continuous one-parameter semigroup. So I, for reasons that I forgot, I quoted this more recent exposition by Simon Hollywood and Werner, but I think the theory really goes back to Davies. So what Becker and Dutta can show is that under, for this kind of setting, so assuming that you have a Lindblad style form of the generator with a Hamiltonian, with a self-adjoint part and a completely positive part. In addition, if you know that, for example, either K, this K here, wait a second, this K, which is should be the negative sum of all the Lj dagger Lj, if K is relatively bounded with respect to H, or vice versa, H is with respect to K, you get a uniform bound of this type here. So for example, in the first case, if K is relatively bounded with respect to H, then in the definition of the diamond norm, we will use H for the energy function. And you get a bound like this. It looks very much like the speed limit. And again, you have a whole family of such upper bounds for different alphas for these modified. Okay, so I think that's the end of my talk. I just have two slides of conclusions. I think the applications, they justify basically why this is a reasonable definition. It's not just some kind of mathematical interpolation between the strong and the norm topology. I'm finishing. It seems the natural setting to discuss the uniform uniformly continuous bounds on channel capacities and these time evolutions. So the application here, I don't want to discuss it because I don't have time. So I just want to bring up this last slide here. I think there are many interesting questions about the applications of this to interesting families of channels. For example, one parameter semigroups. The tricky, of course, is always to find the right H, which may not be given by the semigroup directly. You might have to guess it in some suitable way. So you have to choose it in the right way, and then like Becker and Dutta, they show, and if you choose it correctly, then you can prove explicit bounds on the norm continuity of this one parameter semigroups. And the question I want to highlight here is there some kind of an opposite direction? So if we start off with a diamond norm, energy bound diamond norm continuous one parameter semigroup for a suitable H, do we get a generator that is somehow nice with respect to that H? Or another interesting question would be the family of all Gaussian channels. with the symplectic parameterizations of a single mode or for a finite number of modes, it's just a finite dimensional manifold of channels. What are the explicit concrete continuity bounds in terms of the energy and in terms of the symplectic parameters? Okay, thank you very much. That's it.
Very much. So I have unmuted most of the people. So let us thank Andreas a lot. Are there questions? I don't see anything in the chat. So do not hesitate to ask questions directly to Andreas.
Yes. So thank you, Andreas. It was very interesting. So I was very happy to see the Gibbs state playing some role in the proof. Do you think there's anything essential about something essential mathematically or quantum information theoretically essential about the appearance of the Gibbs state here? Is it just a tool or?
No. I think it makes a lot of sense because the entropy of the Gibbs state at a given energy, that gives you the scale on which which the entropies vary in the first place, right? So if you just look at the set of all states with bounded energy, well, the entropy will be between zero and this value. And so the fact that some such value should appear is I think is very natural and very desirable. So the entropy, the exponential of the entropy of the Gibbs state is some kind of an effective volume of number of degrees of freedom that you have to consider, right? So this is everybody coming from this Boltzmann-Gibbs way of thinking is familiar with this. And somehow the proof it doesn't use this intuition directly, it uses just analytical properties, but it chimes in very well with this.
Thank you. Other questions?
I wanted to ask, what are approximate degradable channels?
Oh, okay. Well, I probably shouldn't ask if you know what degradable channels are. I'm sorry. I used as a basis for the slides an earlier talk, which had a bit of a narrower audience. So this question was left there. So degradable channels are channels where the complementary channel, which is the one that you can obtain from the Steinspring dilation, from the isometric Steinspring dilation of the CP map, by tracing out the other system. In the gradable channel, this complementary channel can be written as the channel followed by another CP map. So it's kind of the what the environment gets is a degraded version of what Bob gets, the intended receiver, and these degradable channels, they are very nice for many capacity formulas. So some of those limits disappear in case. So those obviously in this paper with Sutter, other people from ETH. We considered an approximate version of this, which still allows you to put a bound on the capacity. So the whole theory there worked only for finite dimension cases, or at least finite dimension output, just like this Leeuwen-Smith theory. And so one hope, which for some reason we never actually did it, was with all of those machinery now, we should be able to deal with approximate degradable channels with energy constraints at the input. And rather than evaluating the channel capacity, we would get some kind of computable upper bounds, there's a whole industry in this kind of topic once you realize that the quantities are hard to compute, you need to come up with computable upper and lower bounds.
Thank you.
Ah, hello, Nilanjana. Oh, I see you here.
Yes, any other questions?